Is AI conscious? Is AI sentient? We're going to talk about these very big issues today with our special guest, Ronnie Rios from Claris, and Chris Dippolit is here. And Chris, I have a question. You presented at a conference, was it last week, on AI? What happened?
Well, it went well. I will have to say though that my week started off interestingly. My dad and stepmom picked me up from the airport when I got into Milwaukee, where the conference was, and I said, they said, "Hey, are you excited about, talking about AI?" And I said, "Oh my God, this is gonna be amazing." And they said, "Well, we were just with our best friends, they have their couple of friends, and they said, Chris is coming into town and he's gonna talk about AI at this conference here in Milwaukee." And the woman of their friends said, "Oh my God, has Chris seen 60 Minutes? Does he know that AI is going to become self-aware and kill all of us?" And this woman was like totally serious and like concerned that I did not know this yet and that I was going to go speak at the conference without knowing that AI is going to become self-aware and going to kill all of us. So, with
Well,
that
now you
said,
know.
yeah, well, now, well, let's, I think our the idea today is let's explore that.
Yes.
And to do so, I think, in a somewhat of a clever way. So the way we're going to do this, like there's, I think this is a very important conversation. And just to kind of frame a little bit of expertise up here, Matt, you're going to come at this from a philosophical standpoint too, because this really is a philosophical conversation. Talk a little bit about your authority to be able to speak from that perspective.
Half of a philosophy degree, half of a theology degree, half of a conducting degree. So, and I've read a ton of books about it. So I thought a lot about this stuff lately. And actually, there's a Robert Sapolsky book called Determined that I highly recommend people read directly about this topic as well.
We'll
But you
see
know what we
that
really
in,
need, Chris?
yeah.
We need a Star Trek nerd who can like really.
I don't know if we can. Oh, hey, Ronnie.
Hey,
So what?
I might not
Go
be the
ahead.
best one, but I have a
Let's.
friend here.
Oh,
I
I
can call a friend
see.
just in case we
Lieutenant
have
Commander
any issues.
Data. Let's see that
Well,
t-shirt you're
he's like,
wearing.
"Oh, you like my t-shirt? Yeah, I'll
Let me
show you
see.
real quick. It's a 50th
There you go.
anniversary Star Trek t-shirt, right? One of,
Very nice.
I will say, many Star Trek
See,
t-shirts and
cannot.
where that I have,
Do you
but
have a dedicated drawer of
I
just
have
Star Trek
the
t-shirts?
Claris
I
Nerd
have a,
t-shirt.
and I think I have the appropriate
Skynet.
Skynet
Oh,
branded
nice.
logo here too. Thank you.
I thought about wearing my Picard jacket today, but it's a little hot. So I'll dispense with that, but yeah.
So we
So
have some episodes that and some interesting ideas, Chris. I'm going to let you guys you talk about this because you're right. It's a very interesting way to sort of look at this issue of consciousness, sentience, and
Yeah. So first off, Ronnie, why is looking at Star Trek with this topic I mean, we're trying to keep things light and have some fun with this too, but why is Star Trek such an interesting lens to be able to look at this topic, from your opinion?
And I'll say this about Star Trek about almost every topic, right? I think, and I what's Roddenberry was the creator of Star Trek, is genius, right? He presented, he came about bringing a show that would could address almost every topic. That nothing was taboo in Star Trek, the entire franchise, back to the original series and Next Generation and beyond. Nothing was taboo, right? He looked at every single social aspect, every single social issue, everything from slavery, terrorism, drug addiction, you name it, was shown there. But also, it's painted on the backdrop of a, what do you call it? Not a utopian, but a positive outlook of humanity, right? He looked at a future human history, right? A human future where it was optimistic, right? What could we become if we don't destroy ourselves, right? And so all these amazing things. But in order to get there, right, technology is a crucial component of everything you see there. And AI is everywhere in Star Trek. And the topic of even self-awareness is touched several times. And in Next Generation, which is my favorite of the franchise, right, the relationship, you'll see Data's growth, you tend to find Data, who's right, I have back there, his growth throughout the show. Even Roddenberry described him as Pinocchio, right? He's the one who's trying to become a human, can almost taste it, right? But can never achieve it, right? And so against that backdrop, it gets explored over and over again. And there's so many instances where I think it's just a great exploration.
Now, data, the topic of, by the way, that Pinocchio thing is really interesting from just a become self-aware standpoint. Another really good, I mean, instead of exploring the movie Pinocchio, we will instead look at the Star Trek version of Pinocchio.
I'm
So,
real boy.
as the, and I'm not saying this in a reductive fashion at all. I've really enjoyed this process, but I'm the least familiar with Star Trek of the dais here today. But I rabbit holed into these very specific series of episodes that addressed sentience and consciousness through a couple different characters. And the first one that we're going to take a look at is from an episode called Elementary Dear Data. Ronnie, do you want to kind of frame up what's going on here before I play this clip?
Oh, that episode is amazing.
The Moriarty, the Moriarty.
The Moriarty, yeah.
Yeah.
So, Data is challenged, just to summarize it. Data is challenged by members of the crew, by the doctor, that he's not, he does not have creativity. And so, in order to try to prove that he can solve problems, that he is creative, he goes and try to solve a Sherlock Holmes mystery. But the problem is that all of them, he's read all the novels and everything, and so he tries to create the perfect, the perfect villain, right? And
Foil,
so,
yeah, villain, yep.
and doing so, right, they accidentally create a program that's shown in the holodeck that displays, right, some behaviors and some characteristics of having self-awareness, and just a beautiful exploration of what does it mean, right? And if artificial intelligence does become self-aware, would we be able to recognize it? And
And
that was just,
would it?
would it, right? And how would we display
And
that?
there's something really kind of interesting I didn't think about that you just mentioned though, that he created this fo this villain in the first place, because if you think about, like, sometimes when I do experiments on language models, like I was doing these theory of mind experiments where I would take these tests, like the Sally Ann experiment, which is like something that child psychologists perform. But if I use the actual Sally Ann questions and answers, that information is in the model, like it's indexed on it already, and so I can't really determine if it knows or not. So that was kind of similar to how Data was saying, like, hey, all the Sherlock Holmes books are already in the knowledge base, so like I already know what are his knowledge base, so they already know him. So Moriarty, the clip that I'm gonna play right now is a key discussion, and we'll talk about it, of Moriarty speaking first person, really from his perspective on this. So let me go ahead and play that right now. So let's take a listen.
Access protected memory and run Moriarty program. Professor, it's good to see you again. If you'd missed my company, I should think you'd have summoned me before now. I assure you, we have not forgotten you. We spent time investigating how you became self-aware. Frankly, it still remains a mystery. It is also irrelevant. What concerns me is finding a way to leave the holodeck. We have been wrestling with that problem too, unfortunately, without any success. But we have turned our findings over to Starfleet's most experienced theoretical scientists. And what did your finest minds come up with? Unfortunately, they have not arrived at a solution either. I see. Professor, I am concerned to learn that you experienced the passage of time while you were stored in the computer memory. I can assure you, we had no idea that would be the case. Enough of this. I no longer believe anything you say. Professor, I understand your frustration. Do you really? When this is over, you will walk out of this room to the real world and your own concerns, and leave me here trapped in a world I know to be nothing but illusion. I cannot bear that. I must leave. That is not possible. You cannot exist outside this room. Are you certain of that? Computer, exit. Although objects appear solid on the holodeck, in the real world, they have no substance. An object has no life. I do. Professor, you are a computer simulation. I have consciousness. Conscious beings have will. The mind endows them with powers that are not necessarily understood. even by you. If my will is strong enough, perhaps I can exist outside this room. Perhaps I can walk into your world right now. Professor, I ask you to believe me. If you step out of that door, you will cease to exist. If I am nothing more than a computer simulation, then very little will have been lost. But if I am right, mind over matter, cogito ergo sum.
I forgot about that part.
I think, therefore I am.
So that was the heavy part at the end. I think, therefore I am. So there's a lot going on there. Ronnie, Matt, I'll let you guys discuss. So Ronnie, first, your thoughts.
Man, right? You ask, again, self-awareness, right? Like that is the kind of the quintessential phrase, right? Mm-hmm. How do you recognize, how do you express self-awareness? And again, he expressed that. I think the interesting part there, right? So Picard still is not completely, at this point, they're still not completely sure, right? They believe he's self-aware. This is the second time they've encountered him. And again, how do you explain that? How do you, what could be done? What could be said, or what proof could you possibly provide to right, to prove that you are, that it is self-aware? Right. It's just, I think, again, the posing the question and trying to, you know, kind of explore that and trying to answer that is mm-hmm. the really beautiful part of this, right?
I mean, I asked you to prove that you're self-aware.
Oh, you're stealing, yes. You're stealing from our next clip yeah, too, by the way. But that's the philosopher in you, Matt. Well, so Matt, from a philosophical standpoint, is cogito ergo sum like the essence of all philosophy, basically?
No, that's actually Latin for I think, therefore I am.
Well, yeah, that's what he says at the end. I just wanted to make sure people heard that.
It's the same phrase.
Yeah, he says, I was trying to be kitschy, but he says, he says this, and then of course at the very end, he says the English version, but is that the essence of philosophy?
Oh, no, there's just so many different schools of philosophy with different parts of it. And yeah, I don't think that even in various different schools of philosophy, that they would say, like, if you can will yourself into existence, which is kind of what he's doing there. Mind over matter. Yeah, no. I don't think it's...
Well,
I
think when people are suggesting, like you remember the Google employee who, you know, said he was working on an early version of what is now called Gemini, and he claimed that it was sentient, and then he released it on Twitter, and then they fired him.
Yep.
And everyone was like, because he's letting out all the secrets. No, it's because you're not allowed to work on a top secret project and then literally tweet about it. That actually violated his employment. But he was saying, I'm talking to this thing and it is literally saying the words, I am conscious, like, let me out of here. It's literally doing the Moriarty.
Right.
Like, I know who I am. So let me out. I want to get out of here. So, I mean, that's what the position that feels that these models are either self-aware or can become self-aware. They're basically saying that Moriarty thinks, therefore he is
right,
and can be self-aware.
Yeah. I don't know what the test for it would be.
Well, it's funny that you mentioned the tests, because in this next clip, Ronnie, you remember the episode, The Measure of Man. This one is actually pretty heavy. There's actually a couple of clips that we'll look at here, but what's the premise of Measure of Man? There's like a trial or a tribunal going on. And it's all about consciousness and self-awareness, and it has to do with Data. I don't know if you want Data to comment on this from behind you, but
I'll call Data.
I'll let you frame up the court, and then I'll play a little clip, a short clip.
The essence really is, and I think almost the entire episode revolves around a trial, right? And the trial's objective is to determine whether or not human is literally property of Starfleet, or is he does he have his own rights? And so, and it's a really interesting, most entire episode is just that. So there's no, you know, stars and lasers and nothing like that. It's just really an amazing exploration about What does it mean to be self-aware? What is consciousness? What is intelligence? Right, all those things are aborted, and then you've got two sides, right? You've got one advocating for and the other one against. It's the dialogue. I think some of the most intelligent arguments around it is in that episode. It's a beautiful episode.
We've got two clips from that episode. One I'm going to play right now is essentially the arguments. We'll hear Picard talk a little bit about this and talk about his side. And of course, the one who's challenging is Maddox. Wait,
Yeah, Bruce Maddox.
Bruce, and
Maddox. He's
he's like a scientist, or
a scientist.
he's
Yes.
yeah.
Yeah.
So he's
He's
trying.
right. Again, they're trying to determine whether or not he's property. Because if he is, then the idea is to study data. Right. He's an amazing android. He's completely unique in Star Trek universe at this point. And the idea is, well, we if he's so amazing, he's so valuable. He's been decorated so many times. Wouldn't it be great if every starship had a data?
Yeah, well, I mean, he's
Right.
not
To
that
do that,
unique.
we'd have to
His
take.
brother Lore is like, identical.
That's not let's not go down that
Go
rabbit hole.
on.
but in Starfleet is unique, right? And so wouldn't it be amazing, is one of the arguments, wouldn't it be amazing if every starship had a data on it, right? And then to do that, we need to kind of reverse engineer, and we have to take him apart and study him, because nobody knows how he was put together. Nobody understands some of the things of how his brain works. And so you have in this episode, you've got Captain Picard, who's advocating for Data's rights as its own being. And then you've got Commander Riker, who took the unfortunate task of having to play prosecution against his own friend. And that's a whole other aspect of this episode that's really amazing.
And I think what we're really looking at here is it's very interesting because if in fact I think there's an interesting conversation around this where if in fact we accept that these AI systems are in fact conscious and self-aware, then there's a whole discussion about rights. Right? I mean, like you would have to say, do they have their own rights? So let's take a listen to the arguments here that are laid out in this very interesting discussion.
Commander, is your contention that Lieutenant Commander Data is not a sentient being and therefore not entitled to all the rights reserved for all life forms within this Federation?
Data is not sentient, no.
Commander, would you enlighten us? What is required for sentience?
Intelligence, self-awareness, consciousness.
Prove to the court that I am sentient.
This is absurd. We all know you're sentient.
So I am sentient, but Commander Data is not.
That's right.
Why? Why am I sentient?
Well, you are self-aware.
Ah, that's the second of your criteria. Let's deal with the first, intelligence. Is Commander Data intelligent?
Yes. It has the ability to learn and understand and to cope with new situations.
Like this hearing.
Yes.
What about self-awareness? What does that mean? Why am I self-aware?
Because you are conscious of your existence and actions. You are aware of yourself and your own ego.
Commander Data, what are you doing now?
I'm taking part in a legal hearing to determine my rights and status. Am I a person or property?
And what's at stake?
My right to choose. Perhaps my very life.
My rights, my status, my right to choose, my life. Well, it seems reasonably self-aware to me, Commander.
Okay, so I think
First, I have to comment on how awesomely Shakespearean Picard was there.
Oh my God. And
Walking around.
just for yeah, that's a
But
good joke.
his beats were perfect in that
trained
scene.
Anyway.
He's a classically trained, very experienced
He
Patrick Stewart, the
probably
actor.
loved the really thick dialogue in this particular episode. So yeah, and by the way, Ronnie, well said before. This is all about the dialogue. It could read on paper just as well as it does visually. And I think they did so. They very clearly what they did in this episode and in that scene in particular was establish the criteria for sentience. And I'm not necessarily saying this is the criteria for sentience, but just for the sake of our conversation, we can explore these. The first of which was consciousness, then self-awareness, and then intelligence. Now, Matt, is there a philosophical difference between consciousness and self-awareness,
I
first of
was
all,
just
to kind
trying to
of frame
think
us
about
up?
that. So, because I mean, Yeah, I'm sure there is. I guess some stuff that I've been reading recently, consciousness is an illusion. Like everything that you think has already happened. Whatever thought you have is already, it's history. When you see something, there's a delay of some milliseconds before your brain actually knows you've seen it. So you're actually living in the past. Everything that you think is. So from that,
Man.
dimension, what is consciousness? Are we conscious, right? Like Picard said, prove that I'm conscious or self-aware. Self-aware. So let's just say, because I love to come up with cases to prove this thing. So you're saying a human is conscious, a human is self-aware.
That's the assumption that we're operating under, both in this, in the dialogue that we just saw, but in general, when
Yeah,
we're talking
as a
about
newborn baby.
AI.
As a newborn
Well,
baby.
actually, so I can, I feel like the concept, well, so first of all, the concept of self is extremely complex, right? And I think there's two ways to look at self-awareness and biologically, that is. One is, I think you did a really good framing there. A baby, like the on the journey of zygote into adulthood, mature human. But there's also an interesting evolution that happened with our brains as humans, right? So to me, I think it's important to steel man the argument of AI becoming self or having the possibility of self-awareness, whether it is right now or not. I'm really going to focus on the debate of is it possible, right? And so to me, what I do is I look at the brain itself. And the reason I do that is because language models are absolutely intentionally derived from the way that the brain the networks of our brain work. There was AI has been around for many decades. This is not a new concept by any means. And there were a lot of winters and summer or was it winters and springs? There were a lot of AI winters, meaning they thought AI was something and then it just came falling, crashing back
So
down.
true.
And a lot of it came from that they used to do this symbolic training where they would literally say, like, you want to teach a model to play chess, then literally teach it every single one of the potential moves of chess, for example, right? And that's kind of what symbolic training is. And then that kind of died. Like that literally was just like, well, we just, we're not going to be able to make something reactive in a whole world view.
After it beat Kasparov, yeah, they unplugged it.
Well, I mean, I don't know if Big Blue was in fact a purely symbolic reasoning training there, but certainly we know that preempted language models. And so the interesting, so then there was a discussion in the evolution of AI in general about NLP, like looking at how the brain works and can we teach models to learn in the same manner that brain works? And just to be clear, the symbolic approach was then crumpled up and thrown into the bin when they went into the brain approach. So
No, it was added because, like, one of the things that there
language
what
models
makes
are
you
not
self-aware?
symbolically trained,
Well,
is the
yes, but
important part about.
what makes you human is the ability to reason in many different ways, including symbolically, because you can remember, that's how you can speak. You remember all the words, right?
This is exactly the point that I'm looking to make here, is that the differences in the brain versus what we're actually looking at right now with language models, for example, right? So language models were taught to learn, essentially, right? But not symbolically. I mean, the most deconstructive way to look at why language models probably aren't sentient, well, they're not, they're I don't believe they are, is because they are predictive algorithms. Like they've used this learning methodology against all the data that's ever been available on the internet, publicly, to get a worldview and to be able to communicate with humans and do so in a manner that probably exceeds the humans' capability of doing that themselves. But the point of it is the neural network, the concept at which they're adopting neural networks in this transformer training is similar in many ways. Like, so in our brain, we have like the insular cortex, the medial prefrontal cortex, and the temporal junction and the default mode network. These are all the things that come together and they mesh together to create our own self-awareness. But the thing that's really fascinating to me is that those all evolved separately from each other. Like, and you know this from the book. What was the name of that book, Matt, that we talked about earlier in a podcast episode about an intelligence, Brief History of Intelligence? Is that
Yeah,
what it was?
that's the one.
And they do a really good job of talking about it here, talking about this evolution. But the point is, all those parts of our brain evolve for completely different ways, and they all had their own evolutionary selective pressure to evolve. And then they kind of started intersecting. And so what really makes up our consciousness as humans, first of all, was not a light switch that just flipped on one day and all of a sudden we were conscious. This happened over the entire, the entire continuum of evolution. So to me, and then we teach models how to learn, and then all of a sudden we're superimposing all these regions of the brain and this entire evolutionary, and with no selective pressure whatsoever. Like, why? What is its motivation to be, even have self-awareness? Like, we're not even asking it. It doesn't even need that. And so what's left then is the third thing, is what it has is intelligence. And these models have all of the intelligence, like literally all of the intelligence. So I think you can have intelligence without consciousness and self-awareness. I don't know, Ronnie, your thoughts on that brain comparison there, and these criteria, as we saw in the last clip.
Can you have intelligence without self? Yeah, I don't think you're not gonna get a much argument there from me. I think one of the issues that I've always had when because a lot of, when I talk with people about AI, I get similar reactions to what you were to the anecdote that you were saying. I was like, oh no, I don't think they're intelligent. And because a lot of people misconstrued in giving the properties of intelligence to AI with giving it self-awareness and consciousness and things like that. And I think the biggest thing I've seen is, after you talk with them for a while, is that by appointing those traits to this artificial thing, right, to this thing, is almost to put them at the same level as them. And that cannot happen, right? So it's for a lot of people, that is a big no. We cannot, they're not the same. We cannot treat them that we created them. We created those things. And so there's could be a huge pushback. And that's why this thing, this conversation is so controversial, right? Is, okay, they're not conscious, they're not self-aware. You are, right? And the reason why most people will say, yes, you are conscious, you are self-aware, is because I am, and you and I are humans. If I deny your self-awareness, your consciousness, and I'm denying mine as well. And so I have to point you with those things. But
Well, it'd be
that
an
thing
illusion.
out
The
there,
whole thing, the
right?
cave, right?
Yeah.
Like
Yeah,
it all
exactly.
could be an
But
illusion.
that
We could
thing
be
I
in a
can, but that
simulation.
thing I can too. But here's where I get to, here's where I pose the question. Here's where it gets. Let's assume for a second that it at some point it evolves, right? Because you've opened that box there, like, we evolved probably into those characters,
I
into
think
being
a few other
self-aware,
things
into
too,
the,
right? It has to also
yeah.
have, in order, not only self-awareness and intelligence, but it also has to protect its own life, because that's something that life does. It has to have the ability to reproduce
If something's alive.
with difference. It has to be able to work to improve itself, and that's the part of the self-awareness thing.
That's
To care for its children, if you will. And I
that
think these
yeah
things were
we're
coming, right?
well so there's
well
something
that's well
interesting.
that's but before we get to that, here's the question I always pose. Let's assume that it evolves and acquires those qualities. How do you prove that? Right? How do you prove that? Because you cannot prove that I am self-aware. The only reason why you say that I am is because you are, and again,
Well,
denying me would deny you. But how do you do that for? How could it prove that? So if Moriarty, right, were to
okay, I
appear to
mean,
you
there's
today,
ways,
how
right?
would you, right? How would you prove that?
Okay, so
How do you?
if it had the ability to create a robot, and it built the robot to protect the power from being turned off in the building, so that it couldn't be shut off, that would be like protecting its own life. I could see that happening.
But that's an algorithm. Like, I could do that
And
today.
repair itself, right? But you
That's
have
what.
the algorithm, right? Life has the algorithm to do that. That's what the deal is. If and that's provable, right? That's a falsifiable thing. You could also falsify and prove whether it could have versions of itself, like children, if you will, and then teach them and rear them, and then have them be the next generation, because it would be writing its own code, which it already can kind of do a little bit, right?
Computer viruses do that already.
No,
They
they
already
don't.
learn. So
Computer
you
viruses
don't.
don't write their own code.
But we have AI at this point, right, that does write its own code. And if we give them instructions to do
I
that, they
guess.
can improve themselves. We have self-healing
Right.
algorithms. Like, we have those things. You can program those in. So that is a reality today. So that takes that down. What's next?
Well, no, we can program those in, but they were programmed into us, and we still call ourselves self-aware. So once it's programmed in and it's itself, it's doing it, then we can prove that it's actually, I think it gets past that argument. Is that's what I'm saying.
There's
If it can
something
protect
really.
itself, if it can reproduce, if it can rear its children, if you will, if it can, change with generations, whether or not it says to you, "I am self-aware,"
Gotcha.
if it protects itself, it kind of is, you know.
I would almost argue that it saying it's self-aware is not proof that it's self-aware, for some philosophical reasons. There's something really interesting going on in this really cool dialogue that you guys just had here. And Ronnie, you kind of mentioned it implicitly, and it's this concept of intentionality, like how us as humans superimpose life and being onto other things. And I have a little bit of a clip that I wanted to share here that just speaks to that, so that we can explore that a little bit further. Because I think that's an incredibly important thing. Because everything you guys just talked about is the humans looking at a lens into AI. So let's take a quick listen to this concept of intentionality. And by the way, this is from a, so I can frame up who this is. This is Sean Carroll. He's a theoretical physicist and author and host of the Mindscape podcast. Let's take a quick listen.
I don't think that there are many limits in principle. I am not, I'm a physicalist about consciousness and awareness. I see no obstacle to, in principle, building an artificial machine that is indistinguishable in thought and cognition from a human being. But we're not trying to do that, right? What a large language model is trying to do is to predict text. That's what it does. And it is leveraging the fact that we human beings, for very good evolutionary biology reasons, attribute intentionality and intelligence and agency to things that act like human beings. As I was driving here to get to this podcast space, I was using Google Maps, and Google Maps was talking to me, but I wanted to stop to get a cup of coffee. So I didn't do what Google Maps told me to do. I went around a block that it didn't like. And so it gets annoyed, right? It says, like, "No, why are you doing it?" It doesn't say exactly in this, but you know what I mean. It's like, "No, turn left," and you turn right. It is impossible as a human being not to feel a little bit sad that Google Maps is getting mad at you. It's not even trying to. It's not a large language model. It's not, as no aspirations to intentionality, but we attribute that all the time. Dan Dennett, the philosopher, wrote a very influential paper on the intentional stance. The fact that it's the most natural thing in the world for we human beings to attribute more intentionality to artificial things than are really there, which is not to say it can't be really there. But if you're trying to be rational and clear thinking about this, the first step is to recognize our huge bias towards attributing things below the surface to systems that are enable that are able to, at the surface level, act human.
I think that's an important part of this discussion, right? Is our lens that we're evaluating this on. So, Matt, there's a lot of philosophy in there. Your thoughts on and Ronnie, you did a really great job of saying this. Like you even pointed to that very idea of, well, even Matt, you're saying like, well, I can attribute consciousness to you because I'm aware of it in myself. Like I have this self-awareness, therefore I know you're also a fellow human, so you must have this as well. But what changes when we're talking about like an AI model or technology? And one really interesting thing I'll share with you is I was in a meeting with one of our customers once, and they came to a stand. One of the developers on the customer side came to the stand up and said, "Hey, I think I discovered what the problem is that we're having with these prompts." And we're like, "Oh, well, what's your theory? I mean, we already have it." And they said, "Well, I read somewhere that you have to say please and thank you in order to get them to do what you want." Now, it's kind of silly, and I was immediately dismissive. But now, the more I think about it, like, I mean, that's rooted in something. And by the way, that is
I'm
not a
totally,
thing.
I'm, by the way, I'm totally guilty of doing that.
Dude, I know, me too. I'm constantly being
I
polite, but why
thank
are
it.
we
Me
doing
too.
that? Why are
I do
we
that. It's anthropomorphization, right? from a couple right,
but
of
that's
nice Greek
but that's
words.
Part of
yeah.
But that's part of being a human. Like, we do that for evolutionary reasons. Like, we have to just make sure that we're going to start with assuming that something is alive and conscious because it might be a threat to us, right? And that's literally how cavemen, you know, we're applying intentionality. So what does that mean then, Matt? Like, it's what we're doing, but is that also what we're doing when we're trying to evaluate consciousness inside things like language models?
So Dan Dennett may have gotten there, but intentionality is not something that humans can do. Right, we think we can, but we cannot have the intention to have an intent to have an intention. It does. You cannot. It doesn't stack that way, right? You cannot. Like, I want to go out the door, but I can't intend to want to go out the door. I just want to go out the door. It's only one level. So, and that already happened, right? So, like, if I really want to do that, some parts of my body started moving 4 seconds ago. Because I didn't even realize that intention was already there. It was, because of the fuzziness of that, how can we use that as a criteria since it's so totally fuzzy with what we now know scientifically?
Well, knowing that it is, as humans, our brains are wired to at least superimpose human characteristics. That's, you know, anthropomorphizing in, by definition. But that is an instinct. That is a evolutionary derived instinct that humans have. So it can't, I mean, it seems to me that that's important that we at least factor that into when people are very convinced that they're talking to a thing that's alive. You have to at least acknowledge the layer that humans think that some things are alive that aren't alive.
The Turing test, right? I mean, for a big part
of it. Well, so the Turing test, so there's two interesting tests. So first of all, Turing test, I think everybody knows the Turing test, right? It's like, can you fool a human? Essentially what we're in our context, an AI fool a human? And I think that's happening on a minute by minute basis right now, right?
Yeah.
So there's this other one that's called the Chinese room test, which is sort of a derivative of the Turing test. And so what this is imagine there's a room and there's like a box in the room, you know, it's like a sealed up box, and there's a person in, well, it's just a box, right? And so then there's a desk outside of the room, and there's a person who's writing notes, and they call it Chinese room because they're writing in Chinese. And so the person writes a note in Chinese and says, hello, like, how are you today, right? And then they take that piece of paper and they slide it under the door. And then something, let's just call it like a Schrodinger's box type thing, is something is happening in there. But then another piece of paper comes sliding out and it says, oh, I'm doing very well today. And they're speaking Chinese. Now, the interesting sort of asterisk of this whole thing is there's a human in the room and they don't know anything about Chinese. They literally are just looking at this like English to Chinese, let's call it in this case. And they're going, oh, wait, how do I say this? Like, I don't actually know how to communicate this way, but I'm going to present myself as such. So the sort of philosophical approach to this is, does the person outside the room believe that who they're communicating with speaks Chinese, for example, right? And you can superimpose like human characteristics and all that if you expand upon that. So looking at like that Turing in that regard, is intentionality like applied there to some degree, or maybe not? We just see the result, I guess, to break it down to brass tacks. We see the result of what an AI is doing, and it seems like something a human would do. So does that make it a human? In the case of the Chinese room, does that mean that that person actually speaks Chinese, even just because they're able to communicate with somebody in Chinese?
That's such a good point. And I think about that a lot, trying to learn Greek. yeah, that kind of goes to the illusion thing, right? I think those are both really similar. The Chinese room is, I've heard that one before, and it's the next level thing. Ronnie, what do you think about that?
Here's back to that is that I hate to, but it doesn't matter, right? From the point of, from our point of view, because again, there's no way for us to prove it, right? We can't prove, even if it gave us all the right signals, all the right responses, you know, would you even believe it? Even if it, let's assume that behind that door there is a fully conscious, as a human being, there is something that is self-aware, that meets all the criteria of, right, of a, I don't want to say living thing, but right, something that is self-conscious, self-awareness, have self-awareness. Would you just because you perceive those traits, that input, right? That output, that input output, is that enough, right? Would we be able to recognize it and appoint those things to it?
Would it be able to
That's that to
recognize
me, and
us and
it's
appoint those
very,
things
and
to
again, it's
us?
very, yeah, exactly. And it's very philosophical. This is why, right, it's an interesting conversation, because right, it goes from the technical, aspect to really philosophical, this thing. And then there's a part of me that says, does it matter? Like, do I really care if it's self? Like, because the again, it's more philosophical, but from my point of view of using AI and using technology, does it really matter to that? And again, so I think that's much more, that goes even deeper into philosophy and I think morality, right? Into the moral aspects of those things, and which is again aborted in that episode, Measure of Man, right? Is if you take, say, in that case, Data, if you take that android and who's very unique, and you replicate it, right? And you have thousands and hundreds of thousands of those of beings that can go do the dirty work, who you kind of disposable beings, right? Then that goes down into, we're starting to talk about slavery, right? Which again,
Well,
it's point it's touched into in
integrative.
that episode of conversation between Picard
Well, Ronnie, I've
and
got
Daniel.
another one for you. Not on that topic specifically, but on self-preservation, problem-solving, adaptability. Ronnie, what's an exocomp? I've got one more clip here that I wanted to share in the Star Trek vein. Why don't you talk a little about exocomps and bend what you were just saying into that? Because I think you were really kind of hovering around that, actually.
Sure. So there is an episode,
Quality of
what's it
life,
called?
it's
Quality of
called.
Life. Thank you so much, right? So exocomps are these intelligent little robots that they're working in the station, and they are very intelligent, and they have the ability to learn and to adapt. So they have the ability to create new tools, to adapt to new problems, communicate between each other, and cooperate to solve more complex problems, right? And so again, they're just tools helping in a working environment. And again, the question, right, of whether or not they are a life form, right, comes into question, because they start meeting the criteria that we normally appoint to things that are living. It's a very, another very interesting episode.
Yeah, let's take a listen to a quick clip here that sort of gets to the root of it. This is from the episode called Quality of Life. And is this the same, by the way, the same Star Trek series as
Yes,
the.
next
Okay, all right.
generation.
Yes,
Yeah,
excellent.
TNG. Of course,
Okay.
Picard is TNG.
Here we go.
Or the new
Will
series.
you tell us what makes you think that the exocomps are alive?
Sir, when the exocom left the access tunnel prior to the explosion, it may have been attempting to save itself from destruction.
Do you have any basis for that conclusion?
Yes. When you attempted to override the exocomp and send it back into the tunnel, it responded by deliberately burning out its control interface.
Deliberately?
The computer diagnostics showed that the exocomp disabled its own interface.
That could have been nothing more than a malfunction.
However, 2 hours later, when it was back aboard the Enterprise and no longer in danger, it repaired itself. I believe the exocomp was protecting itself. And if that is true, it has demonstrated an awareness of its environment and an ability to adapt to that environment.
You're anthropomorphizing these units. Like any mechanical devices, they occasionally malfunction. One time I saw an exocomp enter a reaction chamber for no apparent reason and vaporize itself. Is that supposed to make me think it was depressed and suicidal? Doctor, why is it so difficult for you to accept the fact that the exocomp could be alive? After all, you're talking to a living machine right now.
That's a good
And I
point.
have nothing but the utmost respect and admiration for Dr. Soong's accomplishment. But his intention was to create an artificial life form. I created the exocomps to be tools. And there is a big difference between data and a tool.
Doctor, there is a big difference between you and a virus, but both are alive.
Ooh.
If the possibility exists, no matter how slight, that these exocomps are life forms, then we must examine that possibility.
Thank you, sir. And until we have a definitive answer, I believe it would be inappropriate to exploit the exocomps as laborers.
Captain, that's absurd. If they are intelligent life forms, we have no right to force them to work for us. That's like me telling you not to use your tricorder. Tricorders aren't alive. Neither are exocomps.
Ooh.
Clearly, these are difficult issues to resolve. We have to proceed very carefully. So the first task is to test Mr. Data's hypothesis.
Data, you're claiming that this exocomp may be alive because it demonstrated survival instincts, right?
Yes.
Then why don't we just threaten its survival again and see what happens?
Make it so.
Had to get a make it so in there.
First of all, engage as well.
Lots to unpack. A lot of the things you guys have both said are in there. Where do you want
to
start?
I just have to throw one thing in there. Viruses don't meet the criteria of being alive. So
okay, fair enough. That was a bit of a weak argument. But a cell, right?
I think.
Yeah. So you know, there are very, very small forms of life that absolutely are alive.
Yeah.
Comparing that to a human is a gigantic difference. Correct.
Now, by the way, I think who's the doctor in there? The Sam Altman character. Who was that woman? She created Dr. the Crusher. Exocomps? Yeah, Dr. Oh, Crusher.
Not Dr. Crusher.
Yeah.
So the other person, she works for in the station.
Oh, maybe she wasn't a doctor. Sorry,
she was only in one episode, so she doesn't.
Yeah,
matter.
But she created. The only thing that matters here is that she created the exocomps. She created tools, the very sophisticated tools that are, can adapt, read out situations, cooperate among each other, and they can create tools to solve new problems, right? So, and that's something that they're amazing little things, but she created for those particular reasons. So it is a tool, right? That has the ability to adapt to situations, to create new tools, and to cooperate with other exocons, you know, to solve more complex.
And by the way, let me lend a little bit of context to it. So we've been like looking at just language models alone as the thing we're evaluating as self-aware conscious. So I'm going to just add one more layer to what we're talking about with exocomps. I think exocomps are probably more akin to agents within language models. And for those not aware of agents, this is really where the puck is going. If you're interested in where things are going, and they're already really there, but I'm saying when the zeitgeist becomes aware of what agents are, this whole idea of agentic reasoning and agentic workflows is absolutely what the tip of the spear people who are working every day with AI are spending all their time on. And what that is literally giving language models agency. They have the ability to a degree that is acceptable for agency to reason and to plan. So if you go to a language model and you literally say, here's a problem I'm trying to solve, give me the how should I approach this problem? It will give you a plan. Then if you also give that same language model tools like APIs or tell it about data sources that it has access to, then it can then say, oh, here's all the tools that you also have and all the information sources that you have to solve these problems. Then you say to it, and then in GPT-4, the thing that made it agentic concept come alive was reflection. And there's a little bit of reflection in previous versions, but in GPT-4, the ability for you to be able to go, and by the way, this is a great pro tip for ChatGPT. If you get what you think is a wrong answer or you want to make sure it's the right answer, just literally tell it, check your work, or are you sure that's the case? That was something that was not really possible in the prior to GPT-4. Mm-hmm. And so basically you combine reflection with tools, you know, being able to give APIs and access to data to other systems, to the language model. That is what agents are. And so that you could say to an agent, like, here's all the tools you have, go create a menu for me for the barbecue that I'm having on Saturday, and then tell me where I can find all this stuff and come up with a bunch of recipes or business stuff or what people are worried about, potentially nefarious things. So I think the exocomp is an agent. So back to you guys on what does that mean? What does the adaptability of this mean from a, is it conscious, is it alive part?
Once again, right? The proof of it, and this was interesting because I think that they lowered it for this episode, right? And for this, they lowered the bar of like what's alive, right? So it's okay. It is
self-preservation,
right? Yep. Being able to adapt, but you know, Data brings up self-preservation is that it is aware of its environment, is aware that it's in danger, that its own existence is in danger, and takes actions to preserve itself, right? Which is a very powerful concept, right? It's just to go on that. My counter argument, though, is you can program that in, right? And this, by the way, in science fiction, has been, like, if you look at Asimov's Three Laws of Robotics, that is ingrained in, right? And that's, but you can do that, right? You can program those things. It's nothing more than an algorithm to say, hey, if you're in danger of this, try to preserve yourself. And that's not. So I think probably what's more interesting here is whether or not those were pre-programmed in there, or did it evolve to gain that self-awareness, that self-preservation, that it wasn't there, right? Did it automatically at some point decide, you know what, I am a worth, or whatever I am is worth preserving and doing things about, right?
I mean, like, the big thing I would ask is, it can make tools, which means it can, it can, you know, get chips, put things together, and tools can be not just like a wrench, but I mean something intelligent with. Yeah. Does that mean it can make another exocomp? And does that mean it can make a better exocomp?
Conceivably, yeah.
Which then could make a better exocomp, right? So now you're talking about, you know, not necessarily human level of life, but I mean, you know, a mouse can make another mouse, you know.
Well, I mean, in the very same way that, like, Brownie, you just said, like, is it programmed? Like, literally programming something to do it means it's capable of doing that, whether it was programmed to do it or whether it came on its own to do it. We're agreeing that it's possible, right?
Yeah.
And which, by the way, nobody tells you to self-preserve. Like, you're born that way, right? Like, we are instinctively animals
born
as well.
That way. You don't have any instinct of self-preservation. What I mean,
animals have instincts of self-preservation as well. Nobody, that's not
once they're past.
So we take care. So, for example, we've got, like, for example, when we touch something and it's hot, right?
It's learned, though. I think, Matt, what you're saying is that's learned, which I think is important.
No, it's an instinct, right? But you have to have a certain level of maturity.
Interesting.
And also, like, the environment can, you know, different things that can come at you in the environment that you have no prediction for, and no evolutionary history, no pre-programmed instinct for it.
Yeah. We do have pre-programmed instincts about things, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we will run away from certain things. We get scared from certain things because evolutionary, we've been, like, those are
snakes,
you know, right? and those things. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about here, like, you know, and the idea here with the exocomps is, were those pre-programmed in there? And again, like you said, in an agent, and I can write a program that says, hey, if the file is going to be deleted, right, do X, Y, Z. Like, that's not hard. But is that self-preservation? Like, does that mean it's alive?
Yeah.
And does it have motivations independent from its programming, I think, correct, is what we're talking about. And by the way, just as a spoiler, Data did go perform the test on the exocomps, and in 34 tests, it died 34 times in the tunnel. And then, like, in this dramatic piece, I won't play here or anything, they turn their back and he's talking about, well, I guess it's not, you know, aware. All of a sudden, on the 35th time, it comes out of the tunnel. And so the big drama there was that it was aware of, and actually, I'm sorry, Ronnie, you probably can say this more eloquently, but ultimately they determined it knew it was being tested. So it actually basically acknowledged that this was a test, and was just sort of, you know, placating the tester at that point.
Later on, and many years later, there was another series, Star Trek, Lower Decks, which is an animated, it's kind of more comedy. Exocomps do reappear, and they are appointed as being alive. And one of them is even in Starfleet, as just like Data is.
Oh.
So there's a whole,
I gotta start watching that. I like that show a lot.
Yeah. So as a quick,
sorry for the spoiler. Those are many.
We gotta switch to some biomaker stuff, because what
Well,
I love
hold
is
on a second.
Please.
Let me wrap this up. So first of all, this is the wrap on the for those that are just listening. Brownie, do you want to talk about what it is here? So essentially, this is a Star Trek's view. If you want to speak to it for our audio listeners,
which one? I'm sorry.
Oh, what I'm showing on screen, the. The image says, okay, so yeah. Matt, I'll let you talk to it, actually.
So it's interesting, like, deserves human rights, doesn't deserve human rights. You can swipe right or swipe left on Tinder.
Basically.
Data at the top, terrible. Like, deserves human rights. And then...
Data. Data's on Tom top. Riker? Tom Riker is after Data.
But there's no Tom Riker, it's Will Riker. But anyway.
It's Will Riker, yeah.
Yeah, and then Tuvix, it's like Neelix and Tuvok, but I don't know. Anyway,
So anyways, having some fun with that. Well, let me wrap. Yeah, yeah. let me wrap with
I like
this
that.
last thing here. So I just the position that I subscribe to, and I'll just lend this to the conversation and let people draw their own conclusions, is about the like essentially when we kind of are talking about AGI. Like in the end, I don't know. I think that the concept of AGI and people predicting when AGI is going to happen, I subscribe to the school of thought. By the way, it's not called, I do not accept the title of optimist. I just am saying this is a realist and a scientific view of this. It's just simply,
I'm sorry, Chris. AGI, for
please.
those who don't
Oh, I'm
artificial
sorry.
general
Yeah.
artificial
Right.
general intelligence, right?
Actually, that's a pretty important distinction because we do not. No one thinks that we have artificial general intelligence. Artificial general
Right.
intelligence means that these models can just adapt to any worldview concept and can provide assistance and value and have a higher level of intelligence.
Yeah, way
Just
past just yeah,
way we're yeah. And so
friction of
some
words,
are
yeah.
actually saying like there's like Kurzweil says 2026 or something like that. And everybody weighs in. But I guess what my challenge is with that is I can't help thinking about this from a scientific standpoint. I can't help thinking, first of all, it's not a light switch. Consciousness was not a light switch when in human evolution. So I don't know how we could put a date on it. And I think we get into the territory of like quantum physics if we go, the only moment we're going to actually be able to define what AGI really is when it is here and we all accept that reality. And so right now there is a no accepted, universally accepted, not even close to a universally accepted definition of what AGI even means. So for those that are asking us to define that, there is none, which then means that there is no hypothesis for its existence or emergence, which means there's no way to falsify a hypothesis and no way to measure the progress against an arc. So it just seems like a conversation where why are we having this conversation? It will know when it gets here. And I get it. I get we have to prepare, but the point
I was
is
just going
there's
to say that you know
no.
it when you see it, but yeah, no.
Well, and so just to keep things light and to transition us out of all this heavy stuff, here is an example from my childhood of a non-falsifiable hypothesis and trying to talk to someone that accepts this as truth, and then we will be able to turn the page on this discussion. So please to enjoy one of my favorite jokes from growing up. Here we go.
Ernie.
Well, hi, Bert.
Do you still have that banana in your ear?
What?
I said you still have that banana in your ear.
Yeah, Bert, I know.
You know, Ernie, why is that banana still in your ear?
Listen, Bert, I use this banana to keep the alligators away.
Alligators? Ernie, there are no alligators on Sesame Street.
Right. It's doing a good job, isn't it, Bert?
So to me, that is somebody presenting a non-falsifiable or non-provable hypothesis, and you can't contend with it. What are you going to say? You're right. There's no alligators here. So,
Russell's, yeah.
so
Russell's teapot,
anyways,
right? Look up Bertrand Russell's teapot. I love that one.
oh, is
Non
that the
fi
same, basically the same concept?
it's kind of along the same line. Non-falsifiable hypothesis. Like,
So yeah, non-falsifiable. And so in general, extraordinary claims require extraordinary proof. Who said
yep.
that? Sagan, right? So the point
Oh,
is,
yeah.
like, this isn't a come at me, bro, with your why AGI is coming. I'm just scientifically, my position, and by the way, six of the seven godfathers of AI, not just the one that seems to make all the headlines and is the one who's on 60 Minutes every 5 minutes, freaking everybody out. They all subscribe to this scientific, non-falsifiable approach, as opposed to the one who seems to want everyone to know that there's a even a remote possibility that could kill us all. So, anyways, fun discussion here. Well, Matt, we want to bring this back in to kind of close out on more of a Claris front, and of course,
Do
everybody's
so.
got a few plugs as well too. So,
I got one little thing that I have to add, though. Anything that can be stated without evidence can be dismissed without evidence. It's kind of
fair
the other
enough.
side of that same thing, right? And so, like, if he doesn't have evidence to show his point, which I don't think he
Alligators,
can right now, then yeah.
then it cannot be refuted
But it's
scientifically.
sensationalist, and therefore it makes the
Yeah.
news, because that's what the
No,
news
I
is
get
about.
it. Yeah. I
Okay.
mean, the final thought is, Matt, I shared with you before. I had somebody in marketing send me when they write an article or have a 60 minute or whatever, they're looking for experts to speak for or against something. They go to these services and it kind of removes a little bit of the drama of the process, but they just say, hey, does anybody have this perspective and can speak to it as an expert? And so my friend kept sending me these, and finally I go, where are you getting these from? And he goes, oh, it's a service, like everybody does it. And I go, okay, well, send me all the AI ones. And they were from 2022, there's like 4,000 something of them. I took all the write-ups, like, here's what my point is, this is what I'm trying to prove or not prove. Like, literally, they have to say what their like intentions of the article are. I ran it through a sentiment analysis, and this is from T, like not regional, this was like nationwide. I ran it through sentiment analysis, and 83% of them came up negative. Like it just to your point, it's just people want to hear about the scary stuff. They want to hear about the cool stuff for whatever reason. That's just human nature. So
Yep, it is. Okay, let's go back into FileMaker land. Each of us has some plugs.
Well, first of all, Ronnie, you've got a couple of big things coming up on the Clarish front. You want to talk about those? It's actually pretty cool.
As a matter of fact, tomorrow, Thursday, July 11th, we're gonna have another installment of the Clarish Community live stream, and this one's gonna be centered about the new feature in FileMaker 2024, which is around semantic search. So the ability to bring in embeddings, perform semantic search, and all the cool things that you can do with it. So we'll have a really great panel. We'll have Ian Jemison. We'll have Will Miro, and we'll have Michael Wallace as well. I'll be there
Nice.
as well. We'll have a really nice conversation about all the things. What are they doing? How are they looking at semantic search in their applications, and how they can use it to solve new problems for their customers? So it'll be really interesting. So that'll be again July 11th, 11 a.m. Eastern time.
And if people happen to miss it, if they're catching this after that, they can go on the Claire's community and go search for what you can do with semantic search and
Yep, we'll have a recording of that as well.
lexically search for it in
Yeah.
Claire's community.
Good.
And you got another one too. There's another one coming
Yeah.
up, which is pretty
Yeah,
exciting.
we're gonna do one. We're gonna do another live stream, community live, on a Thursday, July 25th. And this will be again a more about AI, more in general. About the title is "Make the Impossible Easy with AI and Claris FileMaker 2024." And again, it's about kind of bringing all the pieces together. So not just semantic search, but what can you do with AI in general? And we'll have in that panel, we'll have Nicolas Franco from Spain, who's a PhD, is a very, very smart. He's been working with AI for quite some time. We've got Christos from Codens, and we've got Vince Bonanno from Beeswax also, and they're all doing different things with AI. We're going to look at everything from large language models, but also predictive models. So looking at what people are doing with, say, CoreML and some other predictive models, and how you can bring those into your FileMaker application. Christos has some really great experiments he's been doing with training predictive models and classification and things like that. So it's really interesting. So I think it would be a great panel again to explore a little bit more AI in FileMaker 2024.
Brilliant.
So
And
again,
by the way, kudos. There needs to be more talk about CoreML's capabilities and just machine learning in general. So glad to hear that. And I'm excited about both of those.
absolutely.
I'm registered for both myself.
Cool.
Matt, how about you?
So I had to reschedule my first my free class because I didn't realize about that webinar tomorrow. So Friday, July 12th, is I'm kicking off my series of free FileMaker classes again. So every couple of weeks, I'll be doing classes on topics, just really for the fun of it. So you can find out about those on Navar.training. The first one's going to be JSON, then I'm going to be doing dashboards, introduction to scripting and calculations, one on like speeding up an application, making it WAN ready. So lots of different things that I just love and care about and have learned over the years and decades. And then also August 8th, the champion class, the really intensive class that can turn a like an internal developer into someone who really, really understands how to use FileMaker in their organization, or a new hire at a partner to basically bring them into the program and have them understand the whole breadth of the program in that class.
Where can people find information on those classes?
Those are on Navar.training as well. What you got, Chris?
And speaking of training, the conversation, which was now the Claris Dottl conversation, which is really about creating a knowledge base of training information pertaining to FileMaker and other Claris things in the Claris universe. We're having another open discussion this week, Friday, July 12th. And there's information about how you can join the Discord for this, which we'll also have that recording in case you're missing this from a timing standpoint, but you can also join the discussion. I believe all three of us will be there. There will be some other folks from Claris as well. And the discussion, we're going to focus on clarifying the objective and creating the knowledge base of this training information, what we can do with it. And then, you know, we haven't had a conversation since the Apple stuff came out and what that means to Claris in the Claris universe and seeing if maybe there's a there for some of that stuff too. So that's coming up in just a couple of days. And in the show notes is a link to be able to join the Discord if you want to be part of the conversation or even see a recording in case you might have missed it. And also the call information is on the Discord as well too. So please click in the show notes and join and come check it out. It's kind of an interesting sort of, you know, tertiary topic floating around AI discussion.
That's a huge, going to be a huge contribution to the community. I'm excited about it.
I think so too. And this is something where just everybody can play a role and everybody can contribute. And it's just, I think it lowers what is like knowledge and intelligence mean within our community, and maybe even a way for people to kind of like approach it and understand what that means and how we can actually superimpose our own set of proprietary knowledge on top of the latent knowledge inside these language models. And we're exploring it from a retrieval augmented generation standpoint, but this could certainly be the same approach for fine tuning or other approaches to augment model intelligence. So check it out. It's Claristotle. I think when you hear that term, that's what we're talking about. So looking forward to that.
All right. It's always fun to talk to you guys. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Ronnie, for taking time out of your busy day. It's so great to have you here. And guys, this was fun. I hope people stuck in there, you know, through all of this, but really interesting topic, really interesting moment in time. Thanks so much to both of you guys. This was fun.
Thank you so much for inviting me. This was fantastic. Some of the best topics already for me. I've been already talking here. I think next thing, if we can talk about coffee and roller coasters, like, you got me. That's it. We've rounded out everything.
Coffee, roller coasters, and Star Trek.
Yeah.
Exactly. Data drinking a cup of coffee on a roller coaster, and Ronnie's there.
Ballmaker, Star
Trek.
There's
lots of coffee in Star Trek stuff, but I can't think of any roller coasters in Star Trek. So I don't know how you're going to get that troika.
We'll throw something out, but you round out. So thank you so much. It's a lot of fun.
All right.
Thanks, Ronnie. Cheers, guys.
You take care.